to nosh, to grab a bite on the run, to sneak a snack on the street, to satisfy a craving. Anosh, Jewish fast food. You never know when the urge to nosh will hit, but when it does, make your indulgences count. For me, there is no better place to nosh than on New York's Lower East Side. Take a pickle place called Gus's on Essex Street.
These are the cucumbers we start with, fresh curbies.
How long has this been?
These are about 3 to 5 days old. New pickles.
It's very crisp and cucumber tasting.
Right.
Is that correct?
New pickles, they're so fresh. They're just in the brine. A lot of people call them overnight pickles.
Uh-huh.
Now the next one, these are half sour. These are aged from 2 to 3 weeks
right.
in the refrigerator.
Uh-huh.
Okay, and they have a more, a stronger garlic taste to them and a little more sour. Taste the salt a little more.
But they're still very crisp.
Yes.
You can taste the garlic more, you're right. These are really, I like these a lot.
Okay, this is a 3/4 sour pickle.
Okay.
This has been aged for about a month.
Mm-hmm. And this one is a lighter color than the...
Well, it's turning brown.
Right.
These are like yellow-green kind of color. And this is turning brown already.
And this one's a little bit softer, but there's more of a garlicky flavor to this one even. I guess the garlic is seeped in.
It's going into that.
It's wonderful.
Guys, hot dog!
Some days, when the need to nosh suddenly strikes, the smell of a street vendor's hot dog is irresistible.
Mustard sauerkraut and conditioned mustard to go, please.
Mustard sauerkraut means a hot dog with mustard sauerkraut?
Yeah.
Is that conditioned?
Yeah.
You come here often?
Yeah.
Are these, you think, the best hot dogs around this place?
Yeah, they're pretty good. A lot of them are, you know, boiled.
Right.
These are grilled.
Right. And that, does that make the difference?
Yeah, I think so.
When I was a kid, there was a hot dog place in the town I lived in, and they had an open grill like that. I haven't had a grilled hot dog at a hot dog vendor since, and this brings back all kinds of memories of my childhood. So thank you for grilling your hot dogs.
Thank you.
A fast food favorite from the Middle East has caught on in the States, falafel.
So tell me, what do you put in?
We put four chickpeas in the bottom, and then we put some tahini on it.
Yeah.
And then we put some, if you want, garif, you want some spices.
A lot of harif. I like it very hot. Oh, wow, that looks great. This looks like the United Nations of falafel makers.
Yes, exactly.
Where are you guys all from?
I'm from Afghanistan.
Afghanistan. And you, where are you from?
Bangladesh.
And you?
Israel.
Israel. And where are you from?
Egypt.
And where's Moshe? Isn't he Israeli?
Yeah,
he's coming. How did you end up coming to this particular corner?
Actually, we started 1981.
Yeah.
And we started with a small kushka. We came over here to 46 and 67.
Well, right around the corner from the Diamond District.
Yeah.
Smart place, huh?
Yeah. And after a while, you're part of the view. And everybody gets used to that you are here, and other pushka, other corner, so everybody respects each other.
How is your falafel different from what your father made?
The story is that my father, just before he died, he gave me the recipe of how it's good falafel. It's made out of chickpeas, spices, vegetables. The chickpeas has a special taste. Also, the chickpeas give crispiness to the falafel.
Now, do you cook yours or do you soak your chickpeas overnight?
We soak it overnight in the water,
and then
we grind it in the morning.
So you don't cook them, you puree them?
No.
Yeah, I think that's the secret of a really good falafel.
Yeah.
And then you put in a hot sauce, which is made from?
Tomatoes
and
crushed pepper, red pepper,
garlic,
and garlic, and salt, of course. And we mix it, we boil it, and that's how it comes.
Which is sort of like a Yemenite spice sauce, isn't it?
Yes, it's actually all the Middle East, part of the meal, if there's a hot sauce is missing, it doesn't call it a meal.
It's not a meal without hot sauce. And then, of course, the tahina.
Yes, the tahina made out of natural sesame seed sauce, and we do the finishing.
It's great, I love it.
Sometimes the best fast food begins at home. My old friend Justin Frank is a psychiatrist during the week who once moonlighted as a restaurant chef. Nowadays, he keeps his family happy and well-fed as their short-order cook.
I had a restaurant for 2 years, and I felt there were a lot of similarities between being a psychoanalyst and being a chef, because I was behind the scenes. Nobody saw what I did or how I did it, like sitting behind the couch. And people would come in and get this food, and they would love it. And so I would see patients in the daytime and cook at night.
And I was a lucky recipient of much of that food.
Yes.
So what are you going to make today? Tell me.
Well, I was going to make the things I normally make on for breakfast. The two main things I make are salami and eggs, which my daughter, Ginevra, loves. And my son, Abe, actually. Joey is less of an egg fan. But I make salami and eggs, pancake style, and I make matzo meal pancakes.
Well, let's start with the salami and eggs.
Salami and eggs is just basic using salami. And we have a tradition in our family also, since I teach in New York. I buy different salamis every week when I'm up there. And we do salami tastings. But this is one of our favorite salamis. And I just slice it. I mean, it's nothing, really. And then I just slice it, usually in half. I make them big pieces, and the kids have to cut them with a knife and fork. In this case, I'll make them a little smaller, because this is a big one. And then I just, that's all I do, is I put them in the frying pan and fry them slowly. I'll show you the matzo meal pancake, which is the main request in the morning, which is what my mother made and my grandmother made. And in fact, their grandmother, my mother, taught
them. And this is German.
This is German, German-Jewish.
Okay.
But, and you always do it in a certain order. You always take an egg, crack it into a thing, a bowl, a ting, and then you beat it up first. Then you just take a egg shell full of water.
It's the kind of recipe
put it in.
I like.
Everything is basic. And then you take an egg shell full of matzo meal, which is now in a bowl for, I'll just dip it in here. And you mix that up.
That way, it depends on what kind of egg you've got.
Right.
Your quantities are correct.
Quantities are the same. Well, actually, you know, I think that this is before they had measuring spoons, and the wandering people would actually just use an egg, and you don't have to worry about anything in addition. So you just use an egg to measure your water and measure your matzo meal, and you've got everything taken care of. And then I use a pinch of salt, which is here, and that's it. And then what I do is I heat up a pan with oil or margarine, sometimes butter if I'm not having salami, and make a matzo meal pancake.
Sounds good.
And that's it. That's really the total prep for everything. It's going to sizzle a little bit, and I wait for the salami fat to burn a little bit.
Now, you have a reason of cutting them this way, rather than dicing them?
I don't like dicing them because you can't make a good pancake that way, so I'd rather cut them in bigger pieces and then just fry them. In the meantime, this is heating up, so I'm going to make a pancake at the same time. And separately, these onions I took out of the oven, so they're going to be added. So this just is only takes a minute, and what sometimes when I'm walking around and setting the table, I throw this on first, and then I go and set the table for the kids. And then it's just about ready, really. And then just put this in. Now that's in, so I can then make a pancake like this.
You need a spatula?
And I'll need a spatula for that. I'll probably use a different one from the salami. I'd rather use a different spatula. This pancake is just about ready. See, it's getting almost, you can see there's a little bit of liquid there. But the pancake is a little bit bubbly. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn it over. Here it is.
Great.
And then I just turn off the stove and it'll be done. And in the meantime, we can put in the eggs.
The other side will cook.
Yeah, the other side will cook with the stove off. And then I just put in this. And that's it. You can just throw this on a plate.
And then when she comes down for breakfast.
When she comes down for breakfast, she'll have matzo meal pancake, which you can eat either with syrup on top, or you can sprinkle powdered sugar and roll it up and make it into like a little crepe. Those are the two basic ways she eats it. I'm going to put in some of the onions because these onions are caramelized to some extent.
Yum.
Which I think the grown-ups will like more than the kids.
Well, I think this, I love to have salami and eggs with onions.
Me too.
Caramelized onions. I think it really works beautifully.
Yep. So the caramelized onions work well. And I make this pancake style. A lot of people make it, if you make it in little small dice, you can make it scrambled.
Right.
And there you go.
Beautiful.
And I turn that down too. Turn it off, in fact. I turn the flame off. As soon as I flip something that's got eggs, I turn it off.
And actually, it doesn't matter if it doesn't come out perfectly, as long as it tastes good.
So that's it. We're ready to serve this too.
Okay. So do you guys do this every Sunday morning?
Yeah, we sit a little farther apart from each other. It's a little homey. But, you know, we're a big family, so it's the way we have to swing it.
Well, it sounds to me, this is a house, I always think of that it's more than the family. There's always extra people here. Is that true?
They're basically family. I mean, we all sleep around in the same bed.
Sometimes noshing can be sweet. Ann Amernick has always had a passion for baking. She's become a renowned pastry chef who did a stint at the White House. Ann bakes a mean rugelach, a crescent-shaped cream cheese cookie that makes for a great snack.
What we want to do is start by putting in 8 ounces of butter.
Okay.
And it should be pretty soft. It can be a little bit melted.
I want to ask you something. If people, religious people, want to make things like rugelach, can they use margarine in this? I know you wouldn't.
People can do whatever they like. Personally, I wouldn't.
Okay. Just wouldn't serve that then?
No, I'd rather not serve it. That's how I feel about it, but I'm very vocal about that.
Right,
now,
so that
I just put in some confectioner sugar and some cream cheese. We're going to use just a little bit of lemon juice. Let's actually get some squeezed here.
And you always use fresh lemon juice, right?
I always do, yes. I think the flavor is incomparable. Maybe a half a teaspoon, something like that. I have about a half a teaspoon of vanilla.
Mm-hmm.
What we're going to do now is just on the very lowest speed,
right.
We're going to mix the butter, the cream cheese, the confectioner sugar, the lemon juice, and the vanilla. Just to combine it. I think we're ready to add the flour.
Okay.
Actually, let's dump half of it in there.
Okay. And always at a low speed?
Always. Whenever you're mixing any doughs, cookie batters, anything, always the lowest speed.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to beat a lot of air into it. It's basically a stir. Doesn't take long, as you can see. Now, what we want to do is chill this dough for approximately an hour at least.
Mm-hmm.
More is better.
So this is one of these things that you could, if you're busy, you can come home, do it, and do it the next day if you want.
Sure. You can probably even freeze it and take it out, thaw it, and use it when you need it.
What's next?
We're going to flour our surface, and then I always like to just knead the dough a little bit by hand to warm it up a little bit and smooth everything in there, because I feel you'll get a more homogenized dough that way.
Mm-hmm.
It helps to have really cool hands.
And what about a surface?
Well, obviously a marble is great, marble, granite, but I've worked on stainless steel surfaces and they're fine too, especially when it's winter and the surface is cold. Now, because we're rolling this out into a circle, mm-hmm. we might as well form the dough into a nice uniform ball and flatten it a little bit. Then we're going to take our rolling pin.
It's a heavy rolling pin.
Yes. Well, that's part of the secret of rolling. The heavier the pin, the less...
You have to move your
arms.
Yes,
exactly. And this becomes critical when you do a lot of rolling. Now, professional pastry chefs a lot of times use a sheeter, but if you don't have access to one, and I like rolling it by hand. I like that feeling. Okay. Now, let's shift this out of the way a little bit. I like plenty of working room when I'm rolling out. I have to end up pushing things out of the way all the time. Now, it helps if you can keep it working in a circular fashion so that you get that form that you're going to need. And I tend to roll things out a little bit thinner in spite of what the instructions are, only because I feel that it will bake better.
And it's nice and even.
It's an, you see how nice and smooth that dough is? It should be. It's from your book.
Looks good.
The next thing we're going to do, this is going to be our apricot walnut rugelach. Uh-huh. So what we're going to do is we're going to spread some apricot jam on here. And what I love to use is an offset spatula. Uh-huh. This may be a little bit more, but I like to spread it out. Sometimes I take the jam and I might work it in the food processor. That's when I use a food processor, just so that I don't have these pieces. But I don't think it's nice to have a little bit of texture to it. We're going to sprinkle some walnuts, chopped finely.
What are some of the other variations that you will have for filling?
Oh, you can use coconut. You can use cinnamon and sugar and butter, brushing it with butter first. You can use shaved chocolate to make a chocolate rugelach. People love that. Anything chocolate, people love.
Right, that is for sure.
Okay. Now, what I do is I use a pizza cutter. Mm-hmm. I find it's great. And I divide it first in half and then in quarters.
All right.
And then I'm going to divide each one of these into four. So I'm going to end up with 16 pieces here. I'll go half again and then half again. Right. And that usually ensures fairly even.
Actually, in my house, I let my kids do this. It's fun.
You would think. Then we're going to roll it up like that and place it on our baking sheet. Make sure that that little end is down so that it doesn't unfold during the cooking. Mm-hmm. This goes very fast.
So it looks really like a horn.
Exactly. As you can see, it's very full.
Let's see if I can help do one.
Okay.
I like doing these things. Oop, mine didn't come out as well, but that's all right.
Well, I wouldn't have said that. Some people actually like to brush them with a little beaten egg and perhaps dust them with a little bit of either granulated sugar or this crystallized sugar. I almost prefer them plain, but that's fine. It's just a matter of taste. So what we're going to do is just brush them with a little bit of this beaten egg.
Okay.
And let's leave a few of them plain.
Okay,
all right?
Absolutely. See the difference.
That's fine.
Now what happens?
Well, we're going to bake these at 350. For about 20 or 25 minutes until they're golden, and then they'll be ready.
And these look delicious.
Thank you.
Better than good enough to eat. Can we eat one?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. I love the fact that you didn't grind the nuts too finely so that there's a...
It gives a little bit of texture, a new dimension. We always look for a new twist.
Mmm, wonderful.
Another Nosh to satisfy your sweet tooth is that traditional New York elixir, the egg cream. I gathered a quorum of egg cream mavens at Sammy's Romanian restaurant to sample, kibitz, and of course critique the egg cream there.
We are starting out with chocolate syrup, Foxy Joubert, 1954.
If anybody tried to make this with Hershey's syrup, it would just forget it.
Well, you know what? There was somebody in town, I won't mention a name, who had a restaurant where they charged like, you know, $30 for an egg cream, and he used some kind of fancy Belgian chocolate. That wasn't an egg cream anymore. No.
The egg cream was what you got as you were in the course of your normal duties around town.
Like Italians.
You had in the garment district, they were all in the corner, corner stores.
Right, you're going to buy the newspaper at the luncheonette newsstand.
What would be a typical dessert?
I didn't have the expertise that I say I had or that Arthur had. All I know is that you went into a place and it had to have a marble counter or it wasn't a good egg cream.
Milk. Milk would be 95, 96, 97.
You've got to watch this and see if it
doesn't make
it
the
right way and then do it.
Just a little.
He's already doing it the absolutely wrong way.
Well, that's right.
What borough would you come from?
I told you, a little outside of Romania.
It's
called the Bronx.
The Bronx.
One more time. What is it doing? Breathing. What do I do while I breathe?
At this rate, we're going to be dead by the time we get our
egg cream. Stop breathing.
No more booze left. You know what that means? Time for egg cream.
Okay, let's do this.
Of course, we all love an egg and an egg cream.
There were no eggs in an egg cream. Now, there are a few stories about that, about why it's called egg cream.
Right.
It was named for Eggs Creamberg, a fourth-rate mobster on Avenue A. Everybody knows that.
See, this will never make a good egg cream.
We'll see what he does.
We'll see if Joan falls off the chair.
You didn't get to the egg cream.
There's no egg cream part.
No, you didn't get down to the chocolate.
Now, I didn't end it. I never
the
got
classic
to the
way that I was taught by the masters, I don't claim it's the only way, is that the first thing to go in is the Fox's Ubet. I certainly agree that Fox's Ubet is the thing. It's very important, however, that the glass be tilted. Put it in straight, you have a flat approach to life.
Like beer, you have to tilt beer, right?
And first, I have to say, with all due respect to the master, you put in too much. That's overly
sweet.
A little bit of chocolate, because of what's going to happen to it, put in on a slant. That's quite enough. That might seem like not much. The glass, ideally, should be the fluted glass that comes out bigger at the top like a Coca-Cola and gets narrower at the bottom. This is
Yahrzeit glass, 1908.
This is a Yahrzeit glass, and it reminds you of tragic events. But we'll try to make the best of it. Next, and this is crucial, you're going to add this, and I have to tell you beforehand, as you add the seltzer, you mustn't do it straight into the chocolate.
Right?
It must be on the same tilt as the glass. And
actually to wash the chocolate down.
To wash the chocolate. A man who knows. And then, did you know this? In the Northern Hemisphere, you have to do this clockwise. In Australia, known as the Sydney egg cream, it's the other way
around.
But
in Brooklyn, they used to go like this.
That's the dunking. The dunking. Yeah. Now, observe. You tilt the seltzer bottle, partly because most seltzer bottles won't work unless tilted, and partly to keep to balance the angle. Can you get that on camera? These two angles are neatly balanced. And let's hope for good pressure here.
Okay.
Failure here, and I have no complaints. Now, Dick, could you help me? Could you keep doing this while I do? Keep the angle.
I was just going to say.
While I do the mixing.
That's it. No, but, oh.
Is this a Social Security egg cream?
Keep going.
I've always been told the seltzer had to go off the back of the spoon.
Now, when it's halfway done, this is the key to the whole thing. You add milk.
When it's halfway mixed.
Had you added the milk with the chocolate, you would have had too gooey a chocolate to mix in with the milk. And the mixture of the milk with the rest is the key to the whole egg cream flavor, which is what was sadly lacking in that very white head we had earlier.
But it was dramatic.
Now, this is the potential for a great egg cream. Now we have to match what he's so good at, which is giving it a good bubbly head. With some bravura at the end.
Wow.
A little bit of overspill. There's a head. I hope the camera can catch it. And we add a little more.
I say, you're better than an elder hostel.
And what you have here is a more integrated egg cream, Joan. Black and white together was popular in the civil rights movement.
That's the taste.
To learn more about Jewish cooking in America with Joan Nathan, visit us online at www.pbs.org. Companion products for Jewish Cooking in America, including Joan Nathan's updated cookbook, a CD of the music score, and a two-hour video of series highlights and recipes, are available by calling 1-800-235-3000. Credit cards are accepted. Jewish Cooking in America with Joan Nathan is made possible by the Joseph S. and Diane H. Steinberg Charitable Trust, proud supporters of the arts, children's causes, and the preservation of Jewish heritage. And by Hebrew National, proud sponsors of Jewish Cooking in America, serving you and your family traditional kosher franks and delicatessen products since 1905. Hebrew National, we answer to a higher authority.
And by Lender's Bagels, our idea of a perfect day is warm and comforting and satisfying all around. Lender's Bagels. The perfect circle.
And by the following private individuals and family foundations.
Thank you.
This has been a co-production of Joan Nathan, Frappe Productions, and Maryland Public Television.
This is PBS.